Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one I call Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the importance of instrumental music within the Education Service.
Minister Graeme Day.
This Government has transformed instrumental music tuition in Scotland schools by supporting councils to eradicate unfair music tuition charges, investing £39 million in the policy since 2021. The most recent Instrumental Music Services survey confirmed that over 61,000 pupils participated in instrumental music lessons in academic year 22-23, the highest number since the annual survey began 11 years ago. I think these figures alone speak for themselves on the importance the Scottish Government places on instrumental music.
Brian Whittle.
Thank the Minister for that question, for that answer, sorry, and I have raised this before in the Chamber. Last week, East Ayrshire Council voted to transfer its instrumental music services to the East Ayrshire Leisure Trust as a cost-saving measure, despite opposition from teachers, unions and parents. In doing so, the Council is relying on drawing a distinction between music tuition for SQA qualifications and tuition for younger pupils or extracurricular activity. And like many other locally, I am concerned that the degradation of music education sets a dangerous precedent which puts access to music education for younger pupils at risk. Will the Minister agree to meet with me urgently to discuss what can be done to ensure that access to instrumental music tuition for pupils in East Ayrshire is protected at all ages?
Minister.
President Officer, I recognise Brian Whittle's interest in this and I will pass his request on to the Cabinet Secretary. But of course it is for individual councils to make decisions around their own provision, albeit within a context where music education is a core part of the curriculum and there is equity of access to instrumental music tuition. Scottish Government officials have engaged with East Ayrshire Council, who have provided assurances that it is not their intention to reintroduce charging and that the move is in fact designed to protect the service from potential cuts to education. I understand the Council has also indicated that pupils will continue to have music under school curriculum and insisted that there are no plans to introduce a two-tier tuition model which separates SQA from non-SQA tradition. Clearly we will be looking for those undertakings to be delivered upon. I hope that offers Mr. Whittle the reassurance he's understandably seeking, but I will pass his request on to the Cabinet Secretary.
Question number two, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the UK Government regarding cross-border machinery theft in rural areas, including the Scottish borders.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government regularly engages with the UK Government on a range of issues. The theft of equipment can have severe consequences for the farming communities and put livelihoods at risk. The Scottish Government works with partners through the Scottish Partnership Against Rural Crime, known as SPARC, which is chaired by Police Scotland, and that's to provide a robust multi-agency approach to rural crime and to support activity at a local level. Police Scotland and SPARC are keen to ensure that Scotland does not offer organised criminals a safe haven and have undertaken cross-border operations with forces in Northern England with the aim of preventing rural crime, including machinery theft by organised crime groups.
Jill Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Thefts of quad bikes, farm machinery and trailers and GPS trackers continue to hit rural communities such as those in the borders. Last September, the Minister kindly assured me that the Scottish Government was looking closely at the Equipment Theft Prevention Act passed at Westminster. However, since the election of a Labour government, there has been no firm commitment to share the consultation responses which would allow me to advance my proposals for a bill in Scotland. Does the Minister recognise, as she I'm sure does, the urgent need for action, and will she work with me to support my proposals for a rural theft bill in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I very much appreciate that Ms Hamilton has asked a number of questions in this vein, given the increasing cost of rural crime, particularly around the impact of machinery being stolen or damaged, and that the link between rural crime and organised crime is very well established. I have asked my officials to consider what the implications of the Members' Bill that was passed in Westminster last year are for Scotland, and what options are available to Scottish ministers. And if I can advise the member that the Home Office are currently drafting regulations with respect to the Members' Bill that was passed last year. They are not as yet in a position to say when these will be introduced, but I will ensure that I and my officials follow this important matter up.
Question number three, Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer the Chamber to my register of interest. My wife is a police sergeant in Moray. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with Police Scotland and what issues were discussed.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, ministers and officials meet with Police Scotland regularly. My most recent meeting was on the 31st of October with the Chief Constable and the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority. We discussed Police Scotland's three-year business plan, focusing on the implementation and oversight of the plan and how it will positively impact on policing in our communities. Regular discussions take place on police workforce numbers, ensuring the strongest possible position for frontline policing is a priority. Police Scotland is taking on more recruits this year since its formation in 2013, and the Chief Constable has stated that she expects numbers to reach 16,600 this week.
Douglas Ross.
The First Minister told me in this chamber that levels of crime in Scotland are at 40-year lows. In the 6 weeks since he said that, he's made no attempt to correct the official record. But the Scottish Government's own figures show that crime increased by 4%. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, have the Scottish Government published incorrect figures, or has the First Minister misled Parliament?
Cabinet Secretary.
It is really important that when we all explore both the long-term trends and the year-on-year increases in crime statistics, that we all fully understand those appropriately and properly. The fact of the matter remains that when we look at long-term trends, that Scotland remains a safer place today than it did when we took office. Where the member raises a very important point is that the nature of crime is changing in this country, and that means that the policing and the response to policing in this country has to also change. And that's why my engagement with the Chief Constable and the Scottish Police Authority is so pivotal.
Thank you. I call Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the very distressing scenes in my constituency that occurred over the bonfire night period, what more support could be given to Police Scotland to combat this? And does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the Fireworks Act of 2022 must now be implemented in full as a matter of urgency to help protect these communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I appreciate the member's commitment in this area and also the work that she has undertaken in years gone by, in particular around the fireworks legislation, the vast majority of which is now implemented. I do also want to acknowledge that many Edinburgh MSPs and other MSPs across the country will of course be working hard to reassure anxious constituents who have had to put up with considerable disorder over the past few days. And I want to put on record my thanks to emergency services, whether that's police, fire and the Scottish Ambulance Service. And while injuries to police officers this year have remarkably been reduced, nonetheless, the level of hostility to our emergency services is utterly unacceptable, and I would like to take this opportunity to remind Chamber and to remind those offenders at large that there is a major investigation ongoing and every endeavour will be made to every effort will be made to find those culprits who've caused considerable anxiety and disorder in our communities.
Question number four, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it provides to local authorities to help secure the future of community libraries.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As Mr Fraser knows, library policy is devolved to local authorities. The Scottish Government provides general revenue funding to local authorities who have the financial freedom to operate independently and to allocate the total financial resources available to them on the basis of local needs and priorities. The Scottish Government's targeted support for public libraries is through our annual funding to the Scottish Library and Information Council and includes the Public Library Improvement Fund that supports creative and innovative public library projects throughout Scotland.
Joe Fraser.
Well, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. I have had numerous constituents contact me raising concerns about the proposed closure of 7 community libraries in towns and villages across Perth and Kinross as a direct result of budget cuts by SNP-run Perth and Kinross Council. Yep. Yep. These libraries are not just resources to lend books, they are important community hubs which host a range of activities, and their loss will be very significant to the communities that they serve. So given the uplift we've seen in the Scottish Government budget, what additional resource will now be made available to local authorities to ensure that these important local assets are retained?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, may I say that I agree very much with Murdo Fraser about the value of libraries, including the community hub aspects of their work. There's a lot of very innovative work going on right across Scotland in terms of libraries changing and providing additional services for communities. So I think the point that he makes very strongly about the value of those libraries is one that I hope that his local authority listens to. In terms of the budgetary process, he'll appreciate that I'm not in a position to give any sneak previews of what may be coming in the weeks ahead. But again, the points that he has raised will have been heard.
Brief supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, can I please ask for any available update on the work of the Scottish Government Public Library Improvement Fund in supporting the vital role of libraries by helping our hard-working library staff bring their innovative ideas to life?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Scottish Government supports the Scottish Library and Information Council, which provides leadership and advice to Scottish ministers, local authorities and the wider libraries sector. In the year 2024-25, we're providing annual funding of £665,000 to SLIC as recognition of the importance of our public libraries and to support the excellent services that they provide. This includes £450,000 for the Public Library Improvement Fund that supports creative, sustainable and innovative public library projects throughout Scotland, with £200,000 awarded to individual projects. 24-25 successful projects are due to be announced soon.
Question number 5, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work that it is doing to support oil and gas companies to collaborate with renewables companies to test and deploy new technologies.
Cabinet Secretary Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're committed to working in partnership with the energy industry to deliver a just energy transition. Our Energy Transition Fund is supporting projects in the North East which promote collaboration across offshore energy sectors. These include the Energy Transition Zone, transforming the region into a globally integrated energy cluster, and a global underwater hub, using underwater expertise, technologies and skills to drive innovation and accelerate the transition. Separately, innovation and targeted oil and gas projects are using floating wind to electrify oil and gas infrastructure, and this helps decarbonise production, whilst crucially enabling the offshore wind sector to expand.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. Many oil and gas companies are already transitioning to renewables. However, during a recent visit to a company in my constituency doing just that, I learned of challenges associated with the complexities and costs of scaling up their testing of floating tension-led platform technology that could offer opportunities for foundation manufacturing here in Scotland. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what support companies like my constituents can access to enable them to scale up testing and move to market entry? And would she be willing to meet with me to discuss this further?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, I'm absolutely delighted to meet with the member and the company that she has spoken on behalf of. As set out in our innovation strategy, the Scottish Government is committed to developing world-leading economic clusters, including in offshore wind. Companies and investors who wish to discuss funding and investment opportunities in the offshore wind sector should engage with the Scottish National Investment Bank and the enterprise agencies who are best placed to advise on what support could be available. But I would also encourage the company, if they haven't already, ready to get in touch with the Net Zero Technology Centre, who provide advice in this area and support to companies that are wishing to innovate.
Question number 6, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what information it holds on levels of compliance with ScotRail's alcohol ban.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Although ScotRail staff will observe some passengers drinking alcohol on trains and in appropriate circumstances ask that they refrain, staff do not record such observations or action each time it occurs on train services. ScotRail do not record or collate instances of those drinking alcohol network ride, but rather data is focused on reported incidents of antisocial behaviour made by passengers or staff to them by British Transport Police, and therefore no information is held. It is known by those of us who regularly travel on our railway that there are instances of non-compliance of the ban.
Yeah. John Mason.
Well, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and as she says, there are frequent non-compliances. I saw it in Dumfries recently, I was on the train, and I see it in Glasgow and Edinburgh frequently as well. I mean, clearly the ban is not being enforced. ScotRail don't like it. Their staff refuse to do anything with it. They joke with passengers who are drinking. And they make no effort to stop them. British Transport Police do not agree with the ban either and say it can't be enforced. So surely we either have to remove the ban or do something to make it enforceable.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the member identifies the dilemma very clearly. That is why I'm actively looking at this issue. Tackling and preventing violence against women and girls and wider antisocial behaviour has to be the main focus, and that was made clear to me and the message I received from the roundtable I held on the 6th of December last year regarding women's safety in public transport. Broader action on antisocial behaviour with or without drunkenness and not the alcohol ban was deemed to be the main focus for action at that roundtable. All rail unions, ScotRail and British Transport Police are of the view that the ban perversely undermines focus on compliance and what is acceptable or not acceptable behaviour and want the ban lifted. However, we also have the public messaging about alcohol to consider, and that is why I'm actively discussing this with my Cabinet colleagues.
Brief supplementary, Graeme Simpson.
Yeah, thank you very much. The Cabinet Secretary has been actively looking at this for long enough. Yeah. I've provided her with a solution. We discussed that in private. I'll keep it that way. But isn't it time that she actually makes a decision and removes the ban?
Yeah, boss.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Graeme Simpson for his engagement on this issue to date and suggestions? I have to consider all the factors, and I have to consider that collectively with my Cabinet colleagues. There are issues that we have to consider. The Equally Safe strategy, there's a strategic review of the Independent Working Group on Antisocial Behaviour, presenting its report to Ministers, COSLA and Police Scotland this year. But I think there is a genuine dilemma. I think in this chamber everybody will have a different view about this. I know some of my predecessors have different views about this. I have to bring everyone together on this, but I am very conscious that if you have something that isn't working, you have to fix it, and I intend to do so.
Thank you. Question number 7, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it is ensuring adequate provision of enterprise support to businesses in Mid-Scotland and Fife.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Businesses of all size and types in the Mid-Scotland and Fife region can access support from a wide range of public sector organisations, including Business Gateway and Scottish Enterprise, through the Find Business Support website. 100 companies with the potential to make the greatest impact on the Scottish economy also receive one-to-one account management support from Scottish Enterprise. In 2023-24, Scottish Enterprise worked with businesses in the region on projects projected to deliver 1,127 real living wage jobs, £36 million in innovation investment, £25 million in capital investment and £188 million in international sales.
Claire Baker.
I thank the Minister for that response. This is Fife Business Week, with a focus on skills delivery and adapting to agile business models through digital technology and solutions. I know from conversations I have with businesses in Fife that increased use of digital technology can increase their competitiveness and efficiency. Since the popular Digital Boost grant funding was discontinued, can the Minister provide an update on what digital support programme support is now available, how this is an improvement on the Digital Boost grant, and how it will benefit those businesses across my region?
Minister.
I thank the member for her supplementary answer. The digital boost schemes, as a member recognises, are still paused. And as I confirmed in a letter to Ms Baker in her capacity as convener of the Economy and Fair Work Committee, despite these specific programmes not being live, helping businesses to harness the power of technology is a core part of modern business support. And as such, the support to digitise is embedded across many business support functions. Examples include Business Gateway, the Innovation Centre programme, the National Manufacturing Institute for Scotland, and many sectoral business accelerator programmes.